Welcome once again. Now, when news emerged on Tuesday that Kenya's President William Ruto had at long last unveiled a list of his proposed cabinet, people from Murang had their eyes scanning the list to see what portfolio Kiharu MP Ndindi Nyoro had bagged. They were, however, shocked when Ndindi Nyoro was not named on the cabinet list. Also, United Democratic Alliance Chairman Johnson Mutama, who was Dr. Ruto's key point man in the Ukambani region, and the party's chief agent, Joseph Nanok, are among key faces that missed out in President William Ruto's 22-member cabinet.
Today, I am proud to announce the men and women who will serve in the cabinet of the Republic of Kenya by God's grace. This exercise is important because although we have a cabinet, which I met with my good deputy this morning, it is also important that we set up the new cabinet early so that we can quickly take charge of the affairs of our country. Other appointments will follow in due course on the other areas that are part of the team that will work with me and my two brothers and the entire cabinet.
Now, also missing on the list was Professor David Ndii, the man behind the bottom-up economic model on which Dr. Ruto anchored his campaigns. The missing names on the list have caused a stir in political space in Kenya, with many wondering what must have gone wrong. Now, let's bring in communications expert and political commentator Awino Gilbert, who joins us live from Kenya. Good morning, and thanks for joining us.
Good morning. How are you?
We are very well. Let's begin with your assessment of the 22-member cabinet that was announced by the president. What's your take?
I think the president, William Ruto, is more concerned with rewarding his friends and partners with whom he was in Kenya Kwanza coalition campaign. And therefore, when you look at the list of the cabinet, quite a shift from the past where in 2017, when he was together with Uhuru Kenyatta, they essentially looked for technocrats. But currently, we have seen that out of the 22-member cabinet, only three are people you'd call technocrats. The former Miano from KenGen, then we have a lady minister for health, and also Eliud Owalo, who has never been in any political position. But he has tried to vie before. The rest are basically people who vied but failed. Some have perhaps been picked from the positions that they won, and now perhaps a by-election will have to be held in their places. So he has given premium to rewarding his friends and loyalists as opposed to what we call technocrats in the previous regimes. We have also seen that the president has been keen to honor his pre-election agreements with partners. He had promised Mudavadi that he would be the chief minister, and indeed that is what he gave him. I have seen you have mentioned Ndindi Nyoro, you've mentioned David Ndii, but publicly it is not known that he had made a promise to any of these people. What we have seen is that publicly what he declared that he would give his partners is what he actually did. The rest have been trying to fit into the political arithmetic of our country and also having 27 in mind. In our country, we have something called Chapter 6 of the Constitution, where leadership and integrity is something that really is of paramount consideration on any serious government position. But we have seen that he has overlooked that. Aisha Jumwa, for example, who is going to be in charge of public service, has a murder case in court. Davis Chirchir, for Minister for Energy, actually was thrown out of cabinet in the 2013-2017 administration because of corruption allegations, but he has brought them back. So those are the things that he has put premium on.
I mean, you've talked about some of the promises that he made prior to coming into office. And now some of the other promises that he did make, I think in an address earlier in the year to Kenya Kwanza Women Forum, he did mention that he would ensure that his cabinet is made up of 50% women. Now, we also know that he did promise that his, you know, public service commission appointments, government appointments would abide by the two-third gender rule. Whilst you would agree that the current cabinet consists of just 7 women, not up to the 50% promise, but in some sense, would you say that, you know, this is in alliance with the two-thirds gender rule which he had promised? Or what is the fuss about? Because we've seen a lot of criticism on social media, people attacking him for that reason. What are your thoughts on this, and what is the general feeling about it?
On the two-thirds gender rule, he has actually performed. He cannot be faulted for that, because in his cabinet, if you look at the list of women, it meets the constitutional threshold. However, he was very loud during the presidential campaigns, and just as he launched his manifesto, he said that 50% of his cabinet would be women. But we have seen that cabinet has about four women, one actually from the previous regime, and then 3 more from now, just who have never been in the previous administration, but some have been politicians. Now, you know, the former deputy president, now the president, is a serious campaigner and also a very loud politician. So most of the things that he said, we still remember them. As to whether he'll be able to meet, let alone the 50% cabinet, all the promises that he had made to Kenyans, that's something that we have to wait and see. Instead, what we have seen he has put a premium on is he has given almost nearly 50%. If you look at that cabinet, 8 cabinet ministers come from the Greater Mount Kenya region. In his community, he has only 2, Murkomen and Davis Churchill. So you can see that he's keen on, maintaining the vote basket of Central Kenya. That is what he has given a premium when he was choosing his cabinet. And perhaps that calls for perhaps looking at what is his new thinking. His new thinking is, we already have this. What do we need to do in future for us to be able to continue having our stranglehold of the political environment in the country? That is what...
Yes. Well, the big names, you know, which were expected to make the cabinet, you know, like we've seen, you were snubbed by the president. This has caused some rancor within the UDA. But, you know, are there any positives, you know, to some of the people, you know, that he did put in there? You know, are there any things to look forward to? And is there any insight as to why he may have excluded some of these persons?
It's easier said than done. You know, it's like when you're courting a lady, you say all manner of things to make sure that this lady accepts you as a man. Once she's in there, she realizes you have power bills to pay, and therefore, maybe I don't have money now, can be. But when you're courting, you can't say I don't have. So essentially, that is what the president now has done. He has looked at what is the realistic thing to do. There are only so few slots, so many slots that you can give. For example, Mudama, you have said that Mudama, one of his UDA chairman, who was expected to make it to cabinet, did not. You have mentioned David D, did not. But let's look at the quality of the people he chose. For example, the Ministry of Finance, he gave to Professor Ndumu. Professor Ndumu was the former central bank boss, and therefore you'd imagine that and is credited for acceptance of M-Pesa into our country. And M-Pesa is widely, everybody has M-Pesa in our republic. And so you think that the president is looking at really in the treasury docket that was marred by corruption. Davis, the person who was there before, was chucked out because of corruption allegations. Perhaps we are looking at someone who, he's looking at someone who'd make things different. But some of these characters, for example, Aisha Juma, it's a wait and see, because some of them do not inspire a lot of public confidence. That's the reason why perhaps some of Kenyans are jittery about certain people. But I know the appointment of the governor is a plus to him. The rest are essentially his cronies, people he relies on. Davis Chirchir is credited for making sure that he wins the elections. He was a former employee at Independence and Electoral Boundaries Commission. He brought him into his cabinet. He was chucked, but he's brought him back. So essentially, he's just looking at, what did I promise my people? And I have to keep this constituency, whom I promised.
At the end of the day, I think the first 100 days in office are, you know, very key in determining how the government is faring, as well as how they are being perceived by the people. Awino Gilbert, thank you very much for joining us. We look forward to having you again.